picture in your mind the pitter-patter of feet going across the concrete floor, the door is opening and closing, and the door, there's like these hanging bell things dangling, jingling, and customers cashing out, and I am arguing with the merchant, insisting that I am gonna buy this product that is 4 times the normal price for a product in that category. What happened? Lightning struck. And tonight, we're gonna talk about why lightning strikes with customers when they buy at times. And we wanna talk about how can we make that happen over and over and over again. So a few ground rules before we get going, okay? So this is hardcore marketing stuff. This is about making money. It's a little crass, that topic. I know, I get it. We just kind of need to be a little bit okay with that. It is what it is. And if anybody's not okay with that, I totally respect that. The prayer room is down the hall. Please pray for me. Okay? We have got some personal stories included. At some point, we're going to turn the camera off for a couple minutes while I tell some of the most embarrassing stuff. Wow. And it's that good. It's that good. Or I won't tell. Because I don't want to be the next Andrew Ingram. So we just got to keep it in the room and don't judge, because I know everybody here has done stuff just as dumb, okay, or gossip, all right? That's the deal. Okay, maybe not as dumb, but you've done dumb stuff. I tend to overdo. So a little bit of background here. We're going to, and buying behavior and customer psychology is very complex. So what we're going to do is we're going to construct a model, because models help us understand real things that are very complex. So by constructing a model, it helps us understand the real thing that's very complicated. We're gonna talk about cognitive versus affective buying and how cognitive and affective marketing are different. We're gonna talk about high involvement and low involvement. Again, buying and high involvement versus low involvement marketing. Does everybody have the handout? About cognitive versus affective marketing. Buying and cognitive versus and high involvement versus low involvement. We're going to talk about cognitive affective and high versus low involvement, and then we're going to look at some examples, and then we're going to have some fun with them. Okay. Then we're going to talk about wholesale customers because not all of us are marketing to end consumers. Not that we don't have to have that in mind. We are actually marketing to end consumers. Often, even if we're selling to wholesalers, okay? We're gonna talk about something I came up with: geeks, nerds, fanatics, gurus, critics, and other nutcases. The fishing story will come up. Okay. And we're gonna talk about the customer decision process. We'll have time for discussion, Q&A, and if we have time after that, I had some fascinating learnings last week that we can tie back, that I don't have in the material, but we can tie, that I was telling Pastor about, we can tie back to this, about digital marketing, the digital economy, the digital data, digital technology, okay? So, buying decisions are not always rational. Dan, would you please turn off the camera for just a minute? Well, the point is, sometimes lightning strikes, right? It just strikes for a person or a whole bunch of people. How do we make that happen? How do we get that to happen? How can we duplicate that lightning strike over and over and over again? Because if you can, you'll have more sales than you can handle. This dude was like, I don't know how I'm going to sell this to you. Give it to me. I mean, I would have tackled him to the ground. What's really going on inside the mind of the customer? Because the fact is, the customer doesn't necessarily realize what's happening, like our little friend up here. Whoa, right? Yep. So, let's start with our model. You all are familiar with left brain versus right brain. Okay? So all of us fit into, we have a dominant, all of us have left and right. Most of us have one that's dominant, okay? You got weirdos like me that are kind of a bit of both, or I'm not even sure, but yeah, actually. But the right brain, right, is dominant for some of us. And these are the artists, the artistes, and the musicians among us, right? These are the Nate Mariolkis that walk among men. Right? Isn't Nate awesome? Isn't he the best? Okay. And then you have the left brain folks, the accountants, the economists, the tax preparation people that we love to hate, right? The IRS agents. Okay. Left brain is about logic, fact, analysis. Right brain is about feeling and emotion. So for marketers, here's our model. Cognitive versus affective. Okay? Those are the terms we're going to use. Cognitive versus affective. Usually, cognitive is fact-based, rational, and deductive. Affective is emotional, feeling, and experiential. What it is like, what it feels like, what it felt like. Okay? So, usually, the marketing's gonna align with where the customer's buying behavior is on this spectrum. This is the first half of our model. Okay? So, in your handouts, which you now have, take a sec, and you've got this page. Just write down, what is your business or what industry are you in? What specific product or service? And then, just take your pen and put a mark on this spectrum of where your product or service is. Now wait, when I say where your product or service is, what I mean is where your customers are buying, where the end customers are buying on this spectrum, okay? Where are they buying? Is it emotional, is it rational? Is it cognitive, is it affective? Is it affective, is it cognitive? Okay? Everybody got a mark? Just put a hash mark or something like that where your customers are. I'll watch when everybody's good to go, then I'll move on. Now, by the way, there's a trick here. I'll do it on the next one. So, everybody's good? All right. Let's talk through some examples, all right? How about financial investments? Cognitive or affective? They're probably pretty cognitive. They should be. A lot of times they are, right? Okay, what about an evening gown? Oh, it's very affective, isn't it, right? How about a flat screen TV? It depends, but when I thought about it, I thought usually you're looking at what are the specs. It's emotional, but you're looking at the specs, right? So it's kind of like, oh yeah, I want that feature and that feature and that feature. So it's kind of a weird one, but.
I would agree with that.
Okay.
I would think it'd be more of the affective side because people are like, emotional.
Wow, look at that. Yeah, look at the biggest screen on the lot.
Truth is, I went both ways on that one.
Did you see that screen?
Yeah.
Oh, my buddies are going to be so impressed when they come over to watch the game.
Yeah, but I got a better example than that that's harder, okay? So how about a personal computer? It's pretty cognitive, right?
I think sometimes it depends on the customer, too.
It does. So next one, how about this? How about laundry soap? It's pretty affective, isn't it? Yeah. How about chewing gum? It's affective, pretty affective. Actually, lipstick was next, and then chewing gum. Both very affective, right? Very how it feels, how I look, how the color is, how I experience it, how it tastes, how I think my breath is. They got the commercial, all this stuff with the young couples kissing. I mean, it's pretty effective. How about this one? How about, I was hoping Pamela would be here. Nutritional supplements. Ooh, it's tricky, but I'm gonna put it here because I think you're kind of thinking about, you know, how many micrograms and milligrams and how many this and how many that and. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. All right. Here's one.
It's a good thing Pamela's not here.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
How about this one? How about?
I am either.
How about automobiles? Now, wait. Now.
Both.
Now. In the Motor City. Okay,
yeah,
it's pretty cognitive. Y'all are on about your thrust ratios and your chassis drives and your torque poundage and your MPHs and feet, this and that, all this stuff, right? I can assure you there are people in like Atlanta who are buying the car because they like the color. I can assure you. So this one really, and if you don't believe that it can be very effective at times because you're here in the Motor City and this is kind of what you know, right? And I'm not from the Motor. If you don't believe me, here's proof, okay? Ready? Two words that prove it can be extremely effective, if not completely. Are you ready? Two words. Zoom, zoom. One of the most effective marketing campaigns for automobiles of all time. Zoom, zoom. Come on. Okay. Everybody okay so far? All right, except that we argued about a couple of them, which it can be tricky. And I'm not saying I'm right. So here's the question. How does affective versus cognitive impact your marketing, all of your marketing? Well, let's think about them a little bit. If it's cognitive, you're gonna provide the customers and potential customers with the specifications. What are the specs, right? If it's affective, you're gonna talk about the experience and what the experience is like. If it's cognitive, you're gonna list the features, but sell the benefits of those features. Okay? Don't sell features, give the features, sell the benefits. If, on the other hand, if it's affective, you're going to talk about how the customers will feel when they use the product or service. Cognitive, usually more details versus less details if it's affective. If it's cognitive, you may compare directly with your competitive or alternative products or services. If it's affective, it's real tricky. You might not really compare all that much with others because it just gets messy and it's tricky. If it's cognitive, more features. Or higher specifications, more car for the dollar, or more car equals more dollars, right? Higher price. Sometimes affective is based on who the customer is. Doesn't matter, it's the same product. It's just who the customer is and when and where and why are they buying, right? Consultative selling, we talked about this last month, works well for affective because you have to establish the credibility. You got to talk the customer through it. They need the consultative often, right? On the other hand, affective testimonials work well about how they feel, how they felt, how they experienced it. In cognitive, the media that works really well, media types that work well for cognitive are things like brochures and pamphlets and stuff like that to communicate a lot of facts, right? Affective, look, here's the easiest, simplest way to tell if marketing is affective. If they're singing and dancing, it's affective, okay? The next piece of our model, high involvement versus low involvement. Whoops. Let's define involvement as the amount or the level of time, it's up here, level of time, energy, and effort that the customer spends. Could be even physical energy, mental or physical. The amount of time, energy, and effort they spend on the purchase, okay? So, take a minute, same exercise, only on the vertical here, put a hash mark where your product is, and again, not where your product or service is, where your customers buy on the continuum. Where do you think they are buying? Where are they living? Okay? Okay. So, let's talk high versus low involvement. Now, when you are doing this, be careful. Think about it carefully because you may be tempted to think it's higher than what it actually is because you're probably really into it. Right? You're into it. You're kind of an expert on whatever it is. So it may be higher for you in terms of how you experience it than what the customers are actually when they buy. Okay? So just a word to the wise about that. Let's talk through some examples of high and low involvement. How about choosing a college? Very high, right? Oops, we did that. Very high. How about buying a house? A lot of time and effort and energy, right? What about bottled water? Almost nothing, right? Almost zero. How about, what's next here? Buying a mobile phone. Kind of middle, right? What about fast food? Oh wait, chewing gum was next. Chewing gum's pretty low, right? Fast food is next. What about the automobile that we talked about? Buying a car, it's pretty high, right? How about, Lord help me, how about an anniversary band, an anniversary ring? Lord help me, it's high involvement. We're going on 20 years this summer, and there have been days in the last 6 months where I'm just like, dear, can we please talk about anything other than anniversary band? Let's talk about what a horrible person I am and all the improvements I need to make to myself, please. So here's the thing about high involvement, low involvement, okay? I didn't say it, I just thought it.
Wait a minute. No, it's our video.
Yeah, I know. But it's gonna be a surprise. Don't spoil the surprise for her, okay? Because she thinks I'm ignoring her. So oftentimes, the more money, the higher the level of energy and the higher the level. But not always, right? Because take a look. Is an anniversary ring more than a car? I hope not. But it's probably actually higher than a car. You show up that night, the guy says, you know, check, tell me what you want. You might go for a test drive. It depends. You do it. It's done. Anniversary band, this is like a 6-month project here. Okay? I'm in enough trouble. Yes.
What happens in your classroom stays in your classroom.
Thank you. Okay, so like with cognitive affective, high involvement, low involvement, usually you're good. The marketing is techniques and the marketing is going to align to the buying behavior, high versus low, right? So you gotta align to it, right? Let's talk a little bit about that. So if it's high involvement, again, more personal selling, consultative selling, right? Makes sense. The customers need that. They need to talk it through. They need to think it through. They might want to talk with an expert. Consultative selling. You're going to provide more details, build more credibility about the product or around the product or service, right? You might compare option A, option B. Cars are a classic case. You may price based on the features and the benefits, and typically more touches. We talked last month, he did a great job talking about the fact that it takes, you know, it often takes multiple touch points with a customer before they make that purchase, that first purchase, right? High involvement. Low involvement. Catchy phrases and logos and symbols, you know, to enhance the product or service recognition because they're not going to spend a lot of time thinking about it, right? Product or service placement is key. A lot of times it's impulse buys. Why do you think they put the soda and the iced tea and all that kind of stuff right at the and the gum and the candy bars and the lighters and all that kind of, and the magazines and all that kind of stuff in the racks right before you get to the checkout counter, pretty much everywhere, because it's low involvement stuff. You grab it as you're going past. That's the reason why you don't go to the grocery store unless you're a lunatic to buy a chocolate bar. You go to, you might go to a, you know, swing by, okay, just for that. You pick it up on your way through if you're normal, okay? There's really little or no personal selling involved. You're not gonna sit down and have a consultation on the chocolate bar, right? It's not gonna, they aren't gonna spend that time with you. You may be willing to spend that time, but they are not. There's just not enough money in it for them. Okay, so here's our model. We combine the two, right? Cognitive affective, high involvement, low involvement. Combine the two. Let's do this exercise next. Where's your product or service, or where is it being bought? Take where you put the hash mark on the cognitive affective, run up, intersect with where you put on involvement, where your customers are. Because where they are, that's where you need to be marketing. Wow. Ain't it cool? Do that with some of our examples. And I'm not going to go through them one at a time, but I just did it with a whole bunch. Does this make sense? College is high involvement, cognitive, typically. An anniversary ring, high involvement, affective. Yep. I mean, it's very affective, right? It's so beautiful. And so when I wear it, I'll feel beautiful. And if he gets it for me, then he, it's because he thinks I'm beautiful and he loves me after all this time, right?
Every kiss begins with K.
Well, we're coming to some of that stuff.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah. Not my K, though. House. House is kind of affective, but pretty high involvement, right? Evening gown, very affective, pretty high involvement. Everybody, make this make sense to everybody?
Yep.
Where are you and where are your marketing efforts, right? We'll talk through some of that. Okay, so now we have some fun. Now that we've got our model constructed, okay, let's have some fun. All right, we're gonna look at some examples of marketing and we're gonna talk about it, cognitive affective and what they're trying to do, all right? So I got some videos. The first one we're gonna look at, video quality is not great on this one. Who wants the Diet Pepsi?
After that commercial, you did.
Okay. Are the Pepsi people smart marketers? Well, let's just assume that they are. Okay. What are they trying to do here? What are they trying to do? Oh, wait. Well, let's start with this. Is it cognitive or affective? Oh, come on. They're singing and dancing out the wazoo, right? So, say it out. Say it louder, Bob.
If you get this, you're gonna feel good. You're gonna have a party. You're gonna have the girls looking at you. You've got. You're gonna have all a great musician.
I mean, it's totally. I mean, wait. I mean, Ray Charles is saying, "You got the right one, baby." And then the I didn't realize this. They're called the girls. The girls are going, come on. They're smart marketers. They know this is not a high involvement, cognitive, think it through purchase, right?
Was that Super Bowl?
Probably it was at one point. Yeah. Speaking of Super Bowl, Super Bowl is really interesting. We have a tradition here at Richard Crisco's church that once a year, we get to the men get together and we watch this thing for this thing called the Super Bowl. And they're really smart about it because what they did, and understand, I have an undergraduate degree in marketing, and I studied some marketing in my graduate degree too. So they're really clever because what they do is they put on the best, most fantastic commercials out there, most innovative, newest, you know, and usually this is the premiere of the commercial. And it's really great because interspersed among those, they know I need to get up and use the restroom and get snacks and stuff. So they put this stuff, guys running around with this football that's not a football, and it's not because it's not round, and there's, you know, virtually no foot involved. And they call this the Super Bowl. I've never seen the bowl other than the snack bowl or the toilet bowl, but they call this the Super Bowl. It's wonderful. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
All right. So let's look at the next one. All right.
I'd like to buy the world a home.
By the way, I think these two are space cadets, man. They look like they're on something. Yep. That guy's got a good voice. Who wants the Coke? Done. Done. Cognitive or affective?
Mostly affective.
It's I mean, singing and dancing, well, there's singing and choreography, right? Young people on a hilltop in Italy. I want to go. Very affective. But what are they doing? It's the real thing. This is what you want. This is what the whole world wants, and you've got it. I mean, Coca-Cola is out for nothing less than global domination.
Right.
They really are. In fact, one of their goals is a Coca-Cola, a Coke product, not necessarily that product, but a Coke product with an arm's reach of every consumer on the planet. Yeah. This should have been your first clue. They're out for world domination. And they're good at it. And they've pretty much got it now.
Mm-hmm.
So, let's talk about this for a minute. Coke and Pepsi have basically programmed, particularly the American consumer, with to buy their low involvement, affective purchase product. Coca-Cola, Pepsi, Coke, Pepsi, Pepsi, Coke, Coke, Pepsi, Coke, Coke, Pepsi, Pepsi, Coke, Coke, Pepsi, Pepsi. You're programmed. We're going out for dinner. What do you want to drink? Coke. What do you want to drink? Pepsi. You don't even think about the other stuff. Hardly ever, right? Most people don't. So, next up is RC Cola. If you're in charge of marketing for RC Cola, I feel sorry for you. Coke's got enough. No, and it didn't end well. RC was in a very, actually an unfortunate, I had to go looking multiple places tonight. I found some, okay? I had to really go looking, and I'm drinking this one myself. I had to go looking. Yeah.
After the hunt.
Yeah. I mean, and Coke's got enough money to pretty much buy, and Pepsi, anybody they want to tell you to drink their soda, right? I would not be surprised if less than 24 months from now, Barack Obama, this is not a reflection on him necessarily, Barack Obama is on TV drinking Pepsi, maybe Coke, right? They can pretty much buy any, they got enough money, pretty much buy any. They got Superman, for crying out loud. They do, Superman. They can get anybody. So if you're the marketing manager at RC Cola, you gotta try something different. Coca-Cola's marketing budget, I believe this was a 2015 number, was $4 billion. Wow. RC Cola is owned by Dr. Pepper Snapple nowadays because after the Cola Wars, they didn't survive as an independent company. So Dr. Pepper Snapple Group owns Dr. Pepper Snapple, RC Cola, and a bunch of other stuff. And for all of that, their marketing budget is 1/10 the size of Coca-Cola's. If you're in charge of marketing for RC, you gotta do something different. What are you gonna do? You gotta try something different. So let's see what they tried. And we'll talk about it. This is actually a valiant attempt. Ultimately unsuccessful for a lot of reasons that we'll talk about some. It also happens to be one of my favorites of all time. You'll see why. But I can identify. What are they trying to do?
Make people look like suckers.
Okay.
Is that cotton?
Think about our model. What are they trying to do? Use our model. They're trying to take the cognitive, the affective, and just move it one tick more cognitive. Yeah. And they're trying to take the involvement and just make it one tick higher. They know they can't do it for everybody, but if they can do it for a bunch, then they can get enough market share that they can then do something else, right? Because let's face it, you're never gonna out-sing and out-dance Coke and Pepsi with $4 billion a year. Ray Charles, right? What are they trying to do? They're trying to move it up one notch and over one notch. Now the problem is they used a very affect, one of the problems is they're just overwhelmed, $4 billion a year and whatever, that was decades ago, but whatever it was in 1980 dollars or whenever it was, 87 or whatever it was, the equivalent, right? They're just overwhelmed, flooded with it, right? They kind of used an affective, fun, funny thing to do a cognitive thing, didn't they?
Right?
And they tried to take something that's, actually it's not bad stuff. They tried to take something that's pretty low involvement and it just, you know, come on. We're so programmed. Coke, Pepsi. I mean, this is how programmed we are with Coke, Pepsi. Coke, hold, just one section. This is how programmed we are. Remember New Coke? Remember it flopped in about 2.5 weeks and they were back to Coca-Cola Classic? That's how programmed we are.
Where in this affective, cognitive, high-involvement, low-involvement, well, mostly the affective, cognitive, where in that range, there is a marketing law that goes around that says once you become the first one in that category, it's hard for anyone else to take the place. for example, we associate Coke with the real thing. It would be next to impossible for Pepsi to come across and be the real thing, mm-hmm. because they have taken mm-hmm. that market share and put their stamp on it. So in the case of RC Cola, you know, they're coming in with not much of a chance of unseating them in those areas. So wouldn't they need to swing a little more?
Yeah, they got to try something. But you're not going to out Affective Ray Charles, or the Hilltop Italy. Whatever. You're not going to out Affective. You're not going to out sing and dance them. You just can't. So they got $4 billion a year of singing and dancing.
So what if you were RC's marketing person? What would you have done?
Well, I didn't get a video. Remember the dude with the James Earl Jones voice? Right? Crisp and clean and no caffeine. Ha ha ha. Right? The Uncola. Right? That actually worked pretty well for 7-Up because they didn't do, I mean, I love the RC commercial, but it just, they had it the wrong way. That was simple and easy, and it was just one tick with a one tick message, right? One tick more with a higher cognitive, with a one tick higher cognitive message. One tick more involvement with a one tick more involvement marketing campaign. And it actually worked pretty well for 7-Up. It actually did. Who wants a 7-Up? You get to 7-Up, Shannon.
I love 7-Up.
Ha ha ha. You also create a whole new circle that they can label their own.
Yeah.
That's true.
They just went with a whole new arena. Yeah.
You got to try something different. Yep. In fact, with the new Coke, remember I said how programmed we are? They had all kinds of people tasting new Coke, and they proved it was actually better, but nobody wanted it. Okay.
Take away from me what I want.
It's your program.
Yeah.
This is a default, right? Okay. Let's look at another one. This is one of the most schmaltzy, over-the-top, ridiculous. First time I saw this commercial, I mean, I kind of thought I was going to throw up in my mouth. It was so ridiculous. Okay. But I didn't because I was being polite because I was being shown it by John Pepper, who was the CEO of Procter & Gamble. And then he told us how effective it was. They had people calling their corporate hotline, ranting practically in tears at how emotional they got over watching. It's fake, people. It's not real, right? But I remember the one lady, he played some of the recordings, and it was like, oh, and when the girl starts to dance, I just, hugely successful. Cognitive or affective? Well, they're singing and dancing, right? Nutcases, geeks, nerds, whack job. What was the line I had?
Frightening.
Yes.
They need a lie.
Yeah. All right. Hugely effective because it connected, right? Lightning struck for Procter & Gamble. And they're about the best marketers anywhere ever. About the best. Let's look at Jared. This one is brilliant.
This is another phrase for marriage proposal. I have absolutely no idea. He went to Jared.
He went to Jared.
Simple, and the simplicity is part of the power. He went to Jared. Okay, what are they doing here? Cognitive or affective? High involvement, low involvement. High involvement, right? Very high involvement. He went to Jerry. Okay, so what are they doing here with this? Just think, what are they trying to accomplish?
They want you to associate excitement with Jerry.
Yeah, okay. And she's happy because he went to Jared, and her girlfriend is probably, or her sister or whatever, roommate or whatever that was, is very jealous and happy and excited with her because he went to Jared. So ladies, you better tell him to go to Jared, right?
It was like, oh my gosh, he went to Jared.
He went to Jared.
No, there's no place else he could have gone. He had to go to Jared.
Well, right? Yeah, and so here's the thing. Here's the thing. If you're a guy looking for a ring, I mean, you know where you go. You got, Uncle Vinny got someplace. There's a warehouse down by the river, right? That's where, you know, right?
In the bubble gum.
But you know that's gonna, right?
I got sucked up into that. I went to Jared and I run into Pamela's girlfriend.
Oh dear. Yeah, yeah. We'll sell you the box for $50. Okay, but they're doing something else here that's subtle, and it's so clever. It's so good. Let me tell you what I think they're doing, okay? If you're, think back to when you were fixing to propose to Jane, or your first wife. She is his first wife, right? So, all right, so, but think about this. Think about this. What, or when you're proposing to Pamela, or when you're proposing to Barbara, or when you're proposing, right, or when you're proposing to Shelley, what is your deepest, darkest fear?
Not have enough money for the ring.
No. No.
She would say no.
What if she says no? Maybe they're marketing to the guys too. She's happy and excited in her. I want her happy and excited that I proposed, right? Not saying no.
That's good, Paul.
She's happy and excited. Her friend, sister, roommate, whatever is happy, excited, jealous, right? Because he went to Jared. I better just tell Vinny, Uncle Vinny, I'm going to Jared, right? Because I can't take the risk of her saying, that is, yeah, affording the ring. That was another high involvement multi-month thing. This ring will be easier to afford. Because, yeah. Yes. So, your deepest, dark, it isn't that you get married and she's the wrong one. That's your second deepest, darkest. Third is, can I afford it? Most deepest, darkest fear is she says no. He went to Jared, and look at the results.
It's good,
I'm going to Jared. Right? Especially when she tells me to. Okay. Let's look at one more. Right? It's a long one. We probably actually won't even look at the whole thing. But already, when you saw on the other screen, do you think you got cognitive or affective coming? Look at this. Mostly, right?
And the fuel, as you mentioned, on the side, it's everything framed.
Did you see where the pillow cap is?
No.
Yeah, there's a pillow cap right up here. So this is the front frame right here. Take the cap off here. And the fuel is actually on the side portion right here. This is not only the frame, but it's the fuel cap too.
So what is
the missing
on
this?
It's
the air box.
Cool.
You can write down the line and look if you want to see it.
It's the result, but it's the frame.
Wow.
But write down the line there.
Good enough. The point made. Right.
Big thing, it's called
61
millimeter throttle.
The 61 millimeter throttle, the torque poundage in the.
Cognitive.
Yeah, no, I know. I'll give you the video. Cognitive. I had actually had a little bit of a challenge finding a good because this just is TV, internet, video. It's just not good cognitive, a good media for cognitive stuff.
So this wasn't a commercial, was it?
Well, I mean, you know, they're going to put it on their website and everything, but yeah. So EBR 1190 RX, come on.
Put to a guy, buying a bike, all
oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. High involvement, right? Yeah. High involvement cognitive. Right? Okay. So here's what we need to think through. We talked about this. Where are your customers? Where's your product or service? Is it in the same place? Are you marketing in the same place that your customers are buying? If you're not, that's a problem. Do you have different customers that are at different places on this thing? How do you target them separately? We'll talk about some of them in a minute, right? How do you promote and price your offering to align to the customers you prefer to sell to? How does your distribution and placement strategy align? Is it ready to grab at the count? Do you have it in a high involvement place, but it's a low involvement product? You're not going to sell much. Where are your competitors? Are they out of alignment? Can you take advantage of that? Maybe, right? Mm-hmm. And how can you better align to where the customers are positioned on this model, okay? I'll leave those questions with you because I want to talk about wholesale customers.
Can I ask one question before you?
Yep. Yep.
Even for things that tend to be affective, I tend to be a cognitive buyer. I am marketing the affective buyer.
Mm-hmm.
So when I am writing marketing material for that affective buyer, where can I go to try to get examples or wrap my brain around the concept of writing for affective?
The best part of waking up. I'll talk through some ideas and some things. So wholesale customers, right? They tend to be much more cognitive. They're probably about here where I put the W in the dot. They might be higher, they might be lower, but you know, they're pretty cognitive, they're pretty high involvement because they're buying a whole bunch and it's for business and it's, right? They may actually be higher involvement than the end customer because this is a business transaction for them. So you gotta cover the bases. And you gotta sell to them, but also and market to them, but also market to the end customer. And you have to show them how your marketing aligns to the end customer. You explain that to them. You get them on board. Now you've got happy wholesaler customers, right? How do their customers benefit? Again, sell benefits, not features. Talk through the features. Explain the benefits of those features. And how does this advantage them? It positions you at a high end of the market. It draws great traffic. It blah, 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 blah. It's good markup, da, 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 da. But be aware that relationships, as we discussed last month, relationships still really do matter. So there is an effective aspect to that, the relationship. Let's talk.
I want to get a picture of that.
Yep. Good?
Yeah,
all right, now let's talk about, I just kind of came up with this. Geeks, nerds, fanatics, gurus, critics, and other nutcases. I brought a friend with me.
An old friend.
I don't even know where I got this. Landing net for fishing. Simple. It's got a hoop. It's got a handle attached with two different screws. Some kind of a basket or mesh, right? Done. Simple. $20, $25, pretty much any sporting goods store, right? I recently had the occasion to buy a new landing net. Let me introduce you to the Ranger Tournament Series model 9788TFB, which retails for about four times the price of a regular landing net. Regular landing net, my landing net. Note that I bought floats to go on it. Note all of the features here, and I could tell you what the benefit is of every one of those features. Okay? Am I a geek, nerd,
yes.
Fanatic,
yes.
Guru,
yes.
Critic, nutcase?
Yes.
Yep. Four times the price of something that works. It works.
You're too much.
Right?
Yep.
So,
you dive in after that one?
The other one? Yeah.
This one?
No. No. This one this one I haven't.
You're not going to dive in after one.
Well, I hope I don't have to.
Yeah.
I tested it.
You tested it?
I tested it out in the pool, too, to make sure. It went down, but real slow. So it was like, okay, I got enough time. Okay, so geeks, nerds, fanatics, gurus, critics, and other nutcases. Speaking as one of them, we prefer the term aficionados. Aficionados. It just sounds a little bit more good. So, where do aficionados fit on our model? Where are they on our model? Probably about there, right? Which is why I said nutcases,
yep.
Right? There are people who will not drink Coca-Cola out of that can or out of a plastic bottle. It must be a glass bottle, and supposedly they can tell the difference. Okay, but here's the thing. They can be your star customers, which is why I put a star there. You think I could tell the net company some things about landing nets and help them improve their product? Point in fact, I was in direct communication with the guy who owns the company about this particular net. I'm not telling. They're very high involvement, even for typically low involvement stuff like Coke, right? It's like soda, high involvement. Won't drink it from a can, gotta be a glass bottle. generally, even pretty affective purchases like the soda become pretty cognitive, right? Remember I said earlier, you may be more involvement and more cognitive than than your customers generally are. That's because, Shannon, you're a tea geek. You just are, right? You just start. Wear it as a badge of honor. I was in a lecture last week with a leading professor from MIT, and he said this. I already had all the materials prepared, by the way. He said this. He said, I love geeks because they show us the future. He wasn't talking about tea, but geeks can show you the future. Where do you need, what's the next improvement? What's the next thing that, what is it? Ask the geeks, nerds, fanatics, gurus, critics, and other nutcases. They'll tell you how to get ahead, how to leapfrog the competition. I have a friend, his son is a total computer nerd geek, whatever, gamer geek, nerd, whatever the right term is. Companies send him experimental, like still in testing and final development, computer gamer type stuff to try it out and give them his feedback. Often, the aficionados require premium product service, right? But they're willing to pay a premium price, ultra high margin, potentially. They want the best. Exhibit A, Exhibit B, Exhibit C, nutcase, right? A lot of times they're frequent. They're not just recurring. Recurring means they'll do it, or not just repeat. Recurring means over and over again. Frequent buyers. You make money on those? Oh yeah. And remember last month we talked about the cost to acquire a new customer versus keep an existing one? Much higher. The geeks, nerds, aficionados, all whatever, they can be your best source of feedback on your product or your service and where you need to improve, what you need to do next, where you need to go. This is why the MIT guy said, geeks show us the future. I belong to clubs of fishing geeks, by the way. There's a number of them. They may know a lot about your competitors. Can you leverage that if you got a relationship? Yeah. They're opinion leaders. So this is why you have frequent flyer benefits, newsletters, clubs, contests, memberships. Sometimes it's annual or monthly. It's often prepaid or even prepaid. Now look, I would never, ever want to denigrate or cheapen the amazing ministry that our friend Shane Willard has. He's got a whole Shane Willard fan club of monthly partners who get some extra, you know, they get a monthly thing that nobody else has access to, right? It's smart marketing.
Yeah.
Shane's smart, by the way, like Shane's scary really smart, by the way. And his brother, who runs the back office, is also very smart. even better, if you can get it automatic, it just goes on the debit card, credit card. Month after month, chink, 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 like Shane. You can get product testing and development advice and field testing from them. I've gotten phishing stuff sent to me. Here, try this out and then tell us what you think. Right? Have it. It's yours. Tell us what you think about it. How did it work? What do you think of this? What do you think of that? The nutcases among us can tell you a lot about how to tweak and where to go, and I like this and I don't like that, and this will do well here and this will do. Be careful, because their needs are sometimes a little different from the most of the market, but you want to really get to the top of your game. These people who are really into it can help you get there. Here's another one. Get their data, get their email, get their phone number, get their birthday, get their spouse's birthday. Get their anniversary, right? I'm pretty sure that Edible Arrangements knows. They know I'm good for a $50 to $100 bill twice a year, early May and early November. Mother's Day, Mom's birthday. They gotta know when my mom's birthday is, approximately, because I'm good for a $50 to $100 bill, depending how guilty I feel about not having seen her lately. That time of year. How about surprises? Surprise them and delight them, right? Giveaways, right? You got extra stuff that's sitting around that you're not gonna get rid of anyway. You do it as a giveaway or a prize or something to them. Make it like it's actually a big thing when it was just leftovers you were gonna throw away, right? You can get them to do advertising for you profitably through testimonials. Bumper stickers, t-shirts, hats, right? They'll pay you an outrageous price to wear stuff that's got your logo on it, and now they're marketing for you, and they paid you to do it for them, for you.
There is actually a really neat example of that I ran across in the last couple of months. There is an essential oil company that their thing is, or one of their things for their marketing is, get your order and take a picture of your order.
Oh, brilliant.
Post it on Instagram with a specific hashtag. You are entered into their monthly giveaway. Oh, that's not the last week.
Brilliant, huh?
That's brilliant.
Yeah.
Now they're doing the marketing for you, and those are the aficionados that are going to be willing to do that. Didn't I?
And it's video.
I know.
For thousands to watch.
Wow. Okay, let's talk about the model, and let's talk about it in the context of the customers are making buying decisions, right? So they're going to identify, I need X, I'm thirsty, or whatever. They're going to do some kind of gathering or search, or what are my alternatives? They're going to evaluate them, I want that one. They're going to make their purchase, and then they're going to think about how happy am I about it, and then they're going to kind of have an internal feedback mechanism that they think through, do I do the same thing over again next time? Let's think through that. So at each stage, you need to be managing what messages you're sending and how you're walking them through this. So maybe need identification and information gathering and search, you're driving awareness, right? And how you do that, affective, cognitive, high involvement, low involvement, right? So you may provide either cognitive or affective info as part of that. But here's the next one. If it's high involvement, they're going to put a lot of effort in here, right? By definition. If it's low involvement, this could be virtually non-existent. Hence, point of purchase. You know, the spur of the moment purchases. Don't take it yet, Shannon. There's more. There's more coming. At the checkout counter, boom, right there. Or here's a great one. You know the hot dog sausage stand as you're coming out of Home Depot? Holy smokes. Talk about perfectly timed and placed product and service, right? And it's like $5 for a stupid sausage, and I buy them. Okay, it's $3.50 if you don't get soda. Also think about how many touches. How many touch points? How many times does the customer need to see you, your product? What's the cycle there? The purchase. Is the purchase going to be different, affective versus cognitive? It could be very different, right? It could be done very differently. And then you've also got the post-purchase evaluation. So this is where you need to have customer support. This is why you get a gazillion surveys. You know, I got a gazillion surveys in email about how did I like the buying the Jeep that she just absolutely had to have. You'll have to do reinforcement and reminders of why did you choose this and why you should choose it again the next time, right? And there's something in feedback often, it's called cognitive dissonance. You can Google it later. Now take the picture, Shannon. But cognitive dissonance is, I think. Cognitive dissonance is a fancy words that mean this. This is what it means. I'm not sure if I made the right decision, and maybe I'll do something different next time. That's what cognitive dissonance, but fancy words, that's what it means. Okay? So what do you do to prevent cognitive dissonance? Well, you get Ray Charles singing, going, "You got the right one, that's the right one." Uh-huh. Right? You reinforce it. You got the right one, baby. Uh-huh. Diet Pepsi. That was the one. You don't need Coke, 7-Up. You got the right one. You chose the right one. In case you were worried. Good?
Very good.
Okay, let's a little bit of discussion in Q&A. We talked about some of this. Are your customers high or low involvement? Are they cognitive or affective? Is your marketing aligned to that? Can you make lightning strike again and again? Can you get your customers' email addresses or something? Can you get their birth date and their spouse's email address out of them? Or their daughter or whatever. And then email spouse or daughter or whatever, "Hey, so-and-so's birthday's coming up, and wouldn't she like some of this specially boxed gift set, deluxe, unique, one-of-a-kind, you know, one-time, special limited offering, overpriced, high-margin gift set of tea because she is priceless."
Perfect.
Right?
Perfect.
The edible arrangements folks know when to email me each year because it's been a good couple of years. It's been multiple years. I buy the same time of year. They know when to email me. They know when I'm going to buy. They know when to remind me. How about this, making lightning strike again and again? What if you can connect with them on FacePlace and get information off of their FacePlace page, like they were in a relationship and now they're not? Maybe they need the Comfort and Serenity tea blend right now. And maybe you can give them a coupon to get a box of it. Make lightning strike again and again and again by tapping into that, is it high involvement, low involvement, targeting right where they are. Is there a niche out there for your product or service based on those dimensions? Is there another group somewhere out over here that you can grow by targeting them and give and doing it, doing the same thing but a little bit differently, and get them without confusing for the rest of the market, right? You gotta be careful. Are you explaining benefits, not features? What are the benefits? How do you leverage geeks, nerds, critics, not jobs, what, I forget the whole thing, aficionados, right? How do you leverage those people? How can you turn them into repetitive buyers again and again and again and again, because they're gonna be very profitable customers if you do it right? And are you walking the customers through the decision process in a very effective, effective way? Your tea has vitamins and minerals, right?
Pardon?
How many vitamins and minerals does your tea have?
Depends on the tea, but yes, it has vitamins.
How many? Pick your favorite one. Six different vitamins and minerals. Here's features. It's got, it actually contains vitamin A, vitamin B, vitamin D, 5 or something, and 18 micrograms of some mineral. That's features, okay? Here's benefits. The vitamins and minerals will contribute to your overall health and well-being, as well as when you drink it, the sensation and how it will make you feel, because you are priceless. It'll just make you feel wonderful. And the vitamins and minerals will contribute to that now and in the future. Mm-hmm. Benefits, features, benefits, right? Okay.
So it's interesting, from a preacher perspective, okay, because you throw church in here as well. Right? One of the things that I tell people all the time is everybody has reachable moments.
Mm.
They are tragedies and triumphs. And if you can be there in those moments, they're open to the gospel at those moments when they may never be open at any time. It's the same thing with what he's saying. They send you an email in November and then whatever other month it was, that's his reachable moment. That's his critical point. Yeah.
And if they're smart, they'll tap into the guilt of, you know, you don't have a birthday gift for mom yet, right? No, I don't. Right, I don't want to miss. And then they'll do all the add-ons. Do you want balloons for $10 or something ridiculous? Do you want chocolate dip strawberry? Do you want a bear for some ridiculous price?
She's worth more than just a minute.
Yeah, and so if you think about Shannon, because she's worth more than, right? But if you think about Shannon, these are some upsell type opportunities that with the tea, right? If they're buying it as a gift, especially, they can get because she is priceless. Right? Okay. 5 minutes. Can I talk about digital data? I'll shut up in 5 minutes if it's boring, because it'll be 8:30. I told you I was at a lecture last week. A professor from MIT who co-authored a book on data technology, on digital technology. Okay, and he told this story. First, he told us that of the top 100, 500, whatever, companies in the United States or in the world 100 years ago, very, very few of them exist today. They were based on industrial manufacturing using steam power, and along came this technology, electricity, which was very expensive to change over and very unproven. So you can imagine how many boards of directors were enthusiastic about putting up the investment for that. But he also told this story. I told Pastor this story Sunday. So once upon a time, there was this emperor, and he wanted to reward a peasant, one of the peasants, for something. And so he said, tell me what you would like. And the peasant said, I'm just a simple peasant from a simple village. I just need to feed my family. Let's do this. Let's take a checkerboard or chessboard, and we'll place a grain of rice on the first square. And on the second square, we'll place two grains of rice. Third square, four grains of rice. And every square, we'll double the amount of rice. And however much rice is on the checkerboard, when we get to the last square, you bag it up for me. I'll take it home. I can feed my family and I'll be happy. And the emperor smiles, peasant. No problem. Done. Right? So they start doing this. Along the way, at some point, the emperor realizes he's been had, because by the time you get to the last square, I'm told it is actually more rice than has ever been produced and harvested in the history of the world. So it's this Mount Everest of rice. So emperor is kind of ticked off, and he does what emperors do when they get ticked off with peasants who have just made them look like fools in front of the court. Yeah, exactly. Off with his head, right? But what's interesting is, that's not the interesting part. The interesting part is, the emperor realized that he had been played by the peasant about the middle of the board. So it was about the middle of the board that the emperor went, whoa, this is getting out of hand, right? About the middle of the board. So, are any of you, anybody here familiar with Moore's Law? Moore's Law. Okay, Chris, you better know it. Moore's Law is that, it basically states that every so often, and there's debate about how long the time period is. Some people think it's about 2 years. Some people think it's closer to a year. Let's just suppose it's 18 months, okay? And this guy, that's what this guy did. The amount of computing power that you can buy for a dollar, $100, or whatever, for the same amount of money, doubles. Said a different way, the amount of data is going to double also. The amount of computing power doubles about every, call it 18 months, right? So now, let's suppose that instead of rice, we've got computing power. And let's suppose that instead of squares on the checkerboard, we've got, this is bonus material, by the way, for the video. Instead of squares on the checkerboard, it's an 18-month time period. And every 18 months, the computing power and the data doubles. I wonder when you cross the middle of the board. United States government started tracking, this guy looked at this. United States government started tracking the number of computers in use in private business enterprise in 1958. Decent proxy for a grain of rice, right? And computing power. Now maybe that was already partway, you know, a couple squares in, but it was still really early, okay? You wanna know when we crossed the middle of the board? According to that, with 18 months, 2006. 2006. So around 2006, in the last 10, 15 years, was when the whoa moment kind of happened with data technology, digital technology, right? You're not sure if we crossed in the last 10 to 15 years, I give you Exhibit A. In the last 10 years, right? Pretty much since 2006. Whoa. Here's the punchline. You ain't seen nothing yet. Ain't seen nothing yet. We're only just a couple squares past the middle of the board where it's starting to stack up. Ain't seen nothing yet. So here's the implications, and it ties back to tonight. You got all your customers, Shannon's customers, are out there on FacePlace and other, and Instagram and all these other places, right? And they're putting data out there. So maybe you can have a bot or something that goes to their Facebook. You can get them to like your page and be friends with them and whatever, and you can gather information on them that you can then use. It may have their anniversary. It may have whatever. It may have, maybe you can get a buck. It would be time consuming to do that for thousands and thousands and whatever. But maybe you can get a buck, some kid from MIT to program a bot to search their, scour their Facebook pages and see when they enter a relationship and when they exit a relationship and when their anniversary is, when their birthday is, figure out who their children are, grown children, and you know their birthday and you know their grown children, and you've got their grown children's email addresses. Now you send their grown children emails a week before their birthday. She's priceless. Send her a gift box of tea, right? Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You can leverage this. If you're not, your competitors are. So you better get ready. You better get with the program is kind of the point of all of this. I went 2 minutes over. You ain't seen nothing yet. The rice is just starting to really stack up. Thank you.